glad to have everyone here today. After last Sunday was a debacle, we found out at the last possible moment that somebody, well, everybody knows, Alberta had tested positive for COVID last Sunday morning, and she took two tests, and she was kind of like really beside herself. And so having been with her prior to that, I was also exposed. Sue was exposed. And for the safety of everybody in our church, we elected to cancel the service last Sunday. Thank you, Reverend Gault, for giving me that good advice, because it was the right thing to do. On the other hand, just so everybody feels comfortable, because there are some who decided it's still too soon to be around us, we tested multiple times this week, and we consulted the doctor as well as the CDC. And because we had negative tests, and it's been 9 days, they said we do not have to quarantine because we had an exposure, but we've had no symptoms, and there's no reason to quarantine. But some people still don't feel comfortable, and so that's okay. It's okay, you know. We all know that this sickness is unpredictable, and I mean, people have died from it, and so there's no shame or embarrassment in being concerned about being in a public place, especially now. It seems like the numbers are going up, but God is greater than this or anything else. Alberta's doing well, Alan's doing well, the kids are doing well, and you know, they probably pulling her hair out being at home with four kids for like 10 days now. She's climbing the walls. But I'm glad that you're here this morning, and we're going to worship the Lord and safely, because we were told there's nothing to be concerned about. And so God says, be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be known unto God, and the God of peace shall guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Let's stand together and let's go to the Lord in prayer. Our Father and our God, Lord, you know that we each and every one of your children have weaknesses, Lord. God, sometimes we are concerned about things that are large and sometimes small, but Lord, we know that your word tells us that we're to cast our cares upon you because you care for us. Lord, we thank you that we can cast our cares upon you. And Lord, we do that this morning. Lord, we come before your presence with thanksgiving. And Lord, we enter your courts with praise, for you are worthy, worthy, worthy. Lord, we ask that you help us to sing your praises this morning. We thank you, O God, for your presence. We thank you, Lord, for the cross. We thank you, Lord, for the empty tomb. We thank you for your Holy Spirit. We thank you for your precious word and the promises that you've given, Lord. Oh God, help us today to see your word anew and afresh, and feed your sheep, Lord, and be exalted, Lord, and meet needs and touch hearts, and Lord, change us, make us more like our Savior today. We love you, and we give this time to you. We've come to worship you, Lord, and to give you the praise that's due your name. Help us to do it, Lord, by inhabiting the praises of your people. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Let's all start out by turning to number 526. All that thrills my soul. We have the blessing of Mrs. Galt to play the piano today.
Can cheer the heart like Jesus by his presence all divine, true and tender, pure and precious. Oh, how blessed to call him mine. All that thrills my soul is Jesus. He is more than life to me, and the fairest of 10,000. In my blessed Lord I see. Love of Christ so freely given, grace of God beyond degree, mercy higher than the heaven, deeper than the deepest sea. All that thrills my soul is Jesus. He is more than life to me. And the fairest of 10,000 in my blessed Lord I see. What a wonderful redemption. Never can a mortal know how my sin, though red like crimson, can be whiter than the snow. All that thrills my soul is Jesus. He is more than life to me. And the fairest of 10,000 in my blessed Lord I see. Every need his hand supplying, every good in him I see. On his strength divine relying, he is all in all to me. All that thrills my soul is Jesus. He is more than life to me. And the fairest of 10,000 in my blessed Lord I see. One day, by the crystal flowing river, with the ransomed I will sing, and forever and forever praise and glorify the King. All that thrills my soul is Jesus. He is more than life to me. And the fairest of 10,000 in my blessed Lord I see.
This next song is one we have not sung for a while. Number 410, My Faith Looks Up to Thee. And so, if you would help us play through one line of it, Mrs. Gall, and then we will. Think about the words as we sing this song.
My faith looks up to thee, thou Lamb of Calvary, Savior divine. Now hear me while I pray, take all my guilt away. Oh, let me from this day be wholly thine. May thy rich grace impart strength to me. through my fainting heart. My zeal inspire. As thou hast died for me, oh, may my love to thee, pure, warm, and changeless be, a living fire. While life's dark maze I tread, and griefs around me spread, be thou my guide. Bid darkness turn to day, wipe sorrow's tears away, nor let me ever stray from thee aside. When ends life's passing dream, when death's cold threatening stream shall o'er me roll, blessed Savior, then in love, fear and distrust remove, oh, lift me safe above a ransomed soul.
We haven't sung that for years, but I love that hymn. All right, would you turn with me to the back of your hymnal as number 647, as we read God's word out loud together. 647. The Lord's Supper. The Apostle Paul writes here, he says, I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. In the same way, also the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. Whoever therefore eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of profaning the body and the blood of the Lord. For anyone who eats and drinks without discerning the body eats and drinks judgment upon himself. That is why my many of you are weak and die. But if we judged ourselves truly, we should not be judged. But when we are judged by the Lord, we are judged, so that we may not be condemned along the world. Amen. Strong admonition. Lord God, as we consider your table, Lord, we remind ourselves it's truly your table. And Lord, we come the way you tell us that we can come and no other way. Lord, help us even this day to remember the reason that you came, Lord. You gave your life as a ransom for us, Lord, so that we would not spend eternity in hell, but have a home in heaven because of your great love wherewith you loved us. We love you. We ask you, Lord, again, to be exalted, to be adored, and Lord, to meet needs of we, your people, today. In thy name we ask, amen. You can be seated. I think I've already shared enough about what happened last Sunday We do have the Thanksgiving basket distribution that we're planning to do this Saturday. We're going to put that together this Saturday because time is fast approaching for Thanksgiving. And it's hard to imagine, but not this week, but the following week is Thanksgiving. And so we want to be able to put together at least 5 Thanksgiving baskets for needy families, whether they're people in our church or outside of our church, a neighbor, a worker, whoever you know that might be able to be blessed by this, we want to reach out and bless them. Now, 5 is not the limit. If we had 10 families, we'd do 10. If we had 20, we'd do 20. There's really not a limit. God has blessed us, and we want to bless others. He didn't give us a blessing just to keep it to ourselves. And so I understand that the cost of food have really gone up. I mean, 25-30%. Every time you go to the grocery store, the cost is continuing to rise. By the way, we found out that Meijer's grocery store has turkeys for 33 cents a pound. That's about the best price we've been able to find. So that's probably where we're going to get the turkeys for our baskets. But just so you know, that is a really, really good price for turkey. And so, but all the other stuff, I'm sure you probably want to buy it someplace else than Meijer's, because they're going to make up for those turkeys somehow. So the journey through the Bible continues. This coming week, we're asking everybody to read Proverbs, Ecclesiastes, and Song of Solomon. Now, there's not a lot there. Between Proverbs, there's 31 Proverbs, okay? Ecclesiastes, there's 12 chapters. And then you have the Song of Solomon. There's not even 7 chapters a day for those 3 books, okay? And so we're doing the journey through the Bible in 1 year. And so in order to make that fit in our workbook, they've asked us to read Proverbs, Ecclesiastes, Song of Solomon. So I ask you to do that as best you can. Fill out your workbook. If you don't have a workbook, there's some here. Okay? And next week, as the Lord allows, the message will probably be given from Proverbs, unless he leads me in a different direction. But try to bring something that we've read this past week so that get all of us into God's Word in a big way. And so asking you to do that. If you're not already doing it, jump on board and start doing it, okay? You see some prayer requests here. I haven't heard any update on the missionaries from Haiti, if they've been released or if they're still being held by the kidnappers. Does anybody know? It seems like they went off the radar as far as the news goes. I did hear of 40 more Christians that were massacred in Nigeria. And it seems like Nigeria is one of the biggest hotspots for Islamic terrorism, and especially amongst believers, because they're trying to extinguish the church entirely in Nigeria. And they've massacred hundreds of thousands of Christians and burned down schools, burned down churches, burned down their homes. And many of the people, these Christians that they're taking, they're making slaves out of them. They're selling them, and they're just doing horrible, horrible things. And so please be praying for our brothers and sisters in Nigeria. I mean, we've got people, God's people, suffering all over the globe. We really do. China, North Korea, and Pakistan, and Indonesia, and all over, like I said, all over the globe, especially in those Islamic countries. If there is anybody that's a believer there, and there are, but most of them are undercover, they really need our prayers. So let's be remembering them. Anybody have any prayer requests this morning that isn't already listed in our prayer book here, prayer handout, or a praise? I might make a praise this morning. Yes, Jim.
Yeah. My granny's friend, she's 39 years old. She has a Tourette's, so never. I don't think she's doing very good, but I don't think she's saved either, so that's really worrisome. I pray for her that she quits drinking alcohol or whatever else she's doing to make it worse. But she's got a little girl about 6, 7 years old.
What's her name, Jim? Do you know? Okay.
She seems like she don't want to fight it. You know, she just
key to that is somebody sharing the gospel with her, you know. She needs to hear the gospel so she knows she has a reason to live.
Yeah.
Yeah. Anybody else? Yes, Doug.
I praise a coworker of mine.
Lee? Sorry?
He was released.
Praise God for that. Great. Great. Okay. Wow. All right. Okay. Let's continue to sing to the Lord. And this next song is going to be on the back of your worship handout. And this song is "The Lord is My Salvation." The Lord is my salvation. I don't think you have the words for that for up here, do you? Okay.
My salvation.
God the Son. Glory be to God the Spirit. The Lord is our salvation. Glory be to God the Father. Glory be to God the Son. Glory be to God the Spirit.
This time we'll receive our offering this morning. As we bow our heads, and Paul will lead us in prayer.
Heavenly Father, oh, how have you blessed us, Lord? Many times we're not thankful for what you've done for us, Lord. But
thank you, Jesus.
Lord, we need
praise you, Lord.
For you sent your Son, only Son, to die on Calvary for each and every one of our sins, Lord. We just thank you for that great love that you performed, that act of kindness to each and every one of us, Lord. We need to be more thankful, Lord. We need to be out spreading the gospel to everyone, Lord, so that they can hear that they've been forgiven and need to accept Christ as their Savior to not go to hell when that time comes.
Yes, God.
Lord, we do pray for this offering, Lord, that it goes to support our missionaries, Lord, that
yes, Lord.
We support your gospel for Asia. Lord, we just thank you for each and every one of those men who go out into their communities every day and proclaim the gospel there in the communities where they live, Lord. We just thank you for each and every one of them, Lord. Meet their needs, whether it be monetary, physical, or spiritual, Lord. We just thank you for them, Lord. And you know what our needs here are, our own local church are, Lord. You've been meeting thus far, Lord. We just thank you,
Lord Jesus.
Meeting those needs, Lord, so we can proclaim the message in our own community here, Lord. Just bless us all for issues, Lord. We just thank you for what you've done for us, Lord. In your name we ask these things, Lord. Amen.
Amen. As we together sing the doxology to the Lord, as we praise him. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. If you will, you can open your Bible this morning to Psalm 126. We were invited to read the Psalms this past week, actually this past 2 weeks, and so it was very, very, very difficult choosing a psalm to speak from today because of the 150 psalms. Every single one of them are just so awesome because of the one who inspired the writers to write them. But the book of Psalms is an amazing book, and especially the 119th psalm, which I'll not address this morning, but I want to give you I want to set the table for you just for a brief moment to let you know something about Psalms, okay? We need to understand who wrote the book of Psalms. Who wrote this book? When was it written? And how did it fit into our Bibles, okay? King David was responsible for most of the Psalms. He wrote at least 73 of the Psalms out of the 150. And probably more than that, where his name wasn't attached to them, but there was at least 73 that his name was attached to, okay? There were some others that were written by a man named Asaph, who was the son of Berechiah. He was also known as David's chief musician. And Asaph wrote Psalm 50 and also Psalm 73 to 83, okay? Moses is the author of the 90th Psalm, and you wonder, how did he get in Psalms? Well, he wrote it, obviously, while he was still living, and they acquired it. And so, what is the Psalms? What are they? The word psalm comes from the Greek word psalmos, okay? Easy, right? It's a sacred poem that's to be sung with musical accompaniment, okay? It's a poem that was written as poems to be sung to music, okay, to be placed in music. But in the Hebrew Bible, which our Old Testament's written in Hebrew, okay, the Hebrew word is called tehillim, tehillim, and it means praises, okay? So Psalms is tehillim in Hebrew, meaning praises. But not everything in this book is praises, okay? In Psalms, we find prayers from God's people who are going through terrible suffering, okay? We find hymns of praise. We find confession of sin, okay? King David had confessed some of his sin in some of the Psalms that he wrote. We find confessions of our faith in Psalms. There's hymns about nature in the Psalms. There's Psalms that teach Jewish history, okay? But in each one of these Psalms, in every one of these Psalms, the focal point for faith is in the Lord. In other words, everything is focused on the Lord, okay? Whether the psalmist is looking back in history, or he's looking up into the heavens, or he's looking around at his problems, okay? He first looks by faith to the Lord. That's the gist. That's the central purpose of this songbook, this hymnal. It was actually called by most people the hymnal of the Jewish people, okay? Some of the psalms have found their way into our own hymnals. Did you know that? Psalm 46, Martin Luther wrote it. And he wrote the song, A Mighty Fortress Is Our God. Or Isaac Watts, who also wrote, O God, Our Help in Ages Past, comes from the 90th Psalm, okay? And so we've got some of the songs in our own hymnal from this ancient book so many years ago. Well, we say who wrote the book. Well, we know who wrote we know some of the people wrote the book, but we know who inspired the words of the book. Always and forever, it's the Spirit of God. God's Holy Spirit breathed into the minds of the writers, and they wrote as he led them. And so we have a copy of God's word for our worship. What's the main purpose of the Psalms? What does God set forth to do. The book of Psalms expresses worship, okay? Psalms encourages us to praise God for who he is and what he has done. That's the purpose of Psalms. It shines the light of greatness of God. It affirms his faithfulness to us when we're going through trouble, okay? And reminds us of the absolute perfection and necessity of his word for his people. The absolute perfection and necessity of God's word for his people. The Psalms give us a clear picture of God who lovingly is guiding his people through history. And also, their response of praise to God are never far from the psalmist's pen. They're praise to God for what he's doing in their lives. The worship of God's people throughout the Psalms lets us see our true hearts devoted to God. Also shows us what sincere repentance is, if you ever had a doubt, okay? And also how lives are changed by worshiping him. The Psalms, in essence, teaches us to have a personal relationship with God as we tell God our hurts, our needs, and we meditate on his greatness and his glory. This is the essence of the Psalms. Well, the message that I have chosen for this book, which I wanted to do something out of Psalm 22 because it speaks about Calvary. I want to do something on Psalm 23 because it shows us the Lord our shepherd, or Psalm 24, which shows us his coronation after Calvary, okay? And I also wanted to do something in Psalm 51 to show us David's repentance and his confession of sin and his cleansing. I wanted to do something in Psalm 119 to show us the value and the purpose and the need of the Word of God, how it meets every area of our lives. But I ended up with Psalm 126. So if you would, and you've already got your Bibles open, follow with me as I read Psalm 126, just six short verses. We'll focus on verse 5 and 6. When the Lord turned again the captivity of Zion, we were like them that dream. Then was our mouth filled with laughter, and our tongue was singing. Then said they among the heathen, the Lord has done great things for them. The Lord has done great things for us, whereof we are glad. Turn again our captivity, O Lord, as the streams in the south. They that sow in tears shall reap in joy. He that goeth forth and weepeth, bearing precious seed, shall doubtless come again with rejoicing, bringing his sheaves with him. The psalmist here speaks about God giving them freedom to go back to the land. But he tells us something. There's some instructions from God for us today, thousands of years later, of what the plan is of God. And the plan is we find joy. We will find the joy of God when we're going, when we spend time weeping, when we're sowing, and when we're reaping. And God's word promises that in this short psalm, okay? They that sow in tears shall reap in joy. He that goeth forth and weepeth bearing precious seed shall doubtless come again rejoicing, or finding great joy, bringing his sheaves with him. Now, I want you to hold your place there because we're coming back to it, but I want to share a couple other scriptures that I feel are supportive of what God is saying to us here. 2 Corinthians 4, 3 and 5, the Apostle Paul says, but if our gospel be hid, it's hid to them that are lost, in whom the God of this world has blinded the minds of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine to them. For we preach not ourselves, but Christ Jesus the Lord, and ourselves your servants for Jesus' sake. Okay? God's word tells us that we have a job to do, okay? And the job is to go out there and to bear the precious seed. And we're going to look at the seed of what he's talking about here in the Psalms and also what the Lord says that we're to be doing. If somebody's house was burning down, would you pull out your garden hose to help save your neighbor from a fire? Anybody? Would you do that? We actually had a situation like that. Our neighbor's house was burning down. Our boys went out and took a garden hose and stopped the fire. Okay. Obviously, we would. Okay. If you were a doctor, would you be able to tell someone if they had a terminal disease? Would you be able to do that? That would be a hard thing to do, tell somebody they're dying of cancer or whatever. How about if you had the cure? That would make it much easier, wouldn't it? You know, when they came out with penicillin, it was a cure to a whole lot of things, right? People were literally dying from simple infections before penicillin, before the invention of penicillin, okay? If you would take the car keys away from a drunk, would you do that? Would anybody take the car keys away from a drunk? Would you do that? Well, of course you would, right? If you could, you would, right? Then you and I should be witnessing to our friends because they're in a burning house. They are like a driver who is drunk going down the road to their eternal death, okay? A person who is lost has a terminal disease. The terminal disease we know is sin, right? We are like the doctor who can tell someone about their sin problem and also tell them about the cure to their sin problem. Amen? The problem of sin is in everyone's situation, everyone's life. Every single human being has got this problem of sin. And we have got the keys. We have got the cure. We have got the answer. What should we be doing about it? If you would sit beside the bedside of an ailing family member, then you ought to invite them to church. God has called upon the people of Solid Rock to buckle down and make the big decisions about life and eternity and what's truly important. We need to set our priorities on getting the gospel out and personally leading people to Jesus and to salvation. God has called you and me to do it. When God looks down on the city of Salem, he sees two kinds of people. You say, well, he sees the young and the elderly, right? No. He sees Democrats and Republicans, right? No. He sees the rich and the poor, right? No. He sees the academically achievers or those who have trouble reading. No. What does he see? He sees the saved or the lost. That's what God sees. Two groups of people. It's not about black or white. It's not about rich or poor or young or old. It's about saved or lost. That's what God is seeing. And the lost are on their way to hell. On their way to hell. In Scripture, the unredeemed, the unforgiven sinners are regarded as lost. Not the politically correct term as being unsaved, but they're lost. Lost. That's what God's word says. Listen, 2 Corinthians 4:3, once again. But if our gospel be hid, it's hid to them that are lost. Matthew 15:24, Jesus answered and said, I am not sent but unto the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Luke 15:6, Jesus says, rejoice with me, for I have found my sheep, which was lost, in his parable of the lost sheep. The sheep that was lost, rejoice with me. In Luke 15, verse 8 through 10, listen about the woman who lost a piece of silver. Either what woman having 10 pieces of silver, if she lose one piece, does not light a candle and sweep the house, seek diligently till she find it. And when she's found it, she calls her friends and her neighbors together saying, rejoice with me, I've found the piece which I lost. Likewise, Jesus said, I say to you, there is joy in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner that repents. Jesus said that. There is joy in the presence of the angels of God. The Gaither Group wrote a song a few years back, and That's when the angels rejoice. That's the name of the song. You got to listen to it sometime when you have a chance. When the angels have a celebration in heaven when one sinner turns their life over to Christ, when one sinner repents. Luke 19, verse 10, listen to what Jesus says. For the Son of Man is come to seek and to save that which was lost. Amazing grace, I once was lost, right? What does it mean to die lost? The best description I can give would come from some deathbed experiences, some quotes from people who died that were lost. Here's some quotes from some people who died that were lost. We don't hear many of them today, and here's why. Because modern drugs keep people so doped up that they often die unconscious. Listen to a couple of these quotes. The author, whose name was Voltaire, he was an atheist who fought Christianity. At his deathbed, he said, "I am abandoned by God and man. I shall go to hell." That's what he said on his deathbed. He died lost. Voltaire, his condition had become so frightful at the time of his death that his friends left his bedside. His nurse said repeatedly, "For all the wealth of Europe, I would never see another atheist die." She watched him die. Thomas Hobbes, he was an English philosopher. He's a scientist, a historian, but he was also an atheist. Best known for his political philosophy, especially a masterpiece that he wrote called Leviathan, upon whom deathbed is quoted as saying, "I am taking a fearful leap into the dark." All the things that he was, but he was lost. And on his deathbed, he says, "I'm taking a fearful leap into the dark." Sir Thomas Scott, Chancellor of England, he said, "Until this moment, I thought there was neither God nor hell. Now I know that there are both, and I am doomed to perdition by the just judgment of the Almighty." As he left this earth. Charles IX, King of France, also an atheist, said this on his deathbed, "What blood, what murders, what evil counsels I have followed, I am lost. I see it well." In the dying moments, there was a French statesman called Talleyrand, also an atheist. He cried, "I am suffering the pangs of the damned," on his deathbed. They didn't have, you know, this drip that they give people now and slowly put people to death by giving them, you know, the drugs so that they just slowly go to sleep. These guys died fully conscious, and on their deathbed, they saw the reality of hell, that they had denied the Savior their entire lives. Thomas Paine, an English-born political activist, helped to inspire the American Revolution, but he was an atheist. And on his deathbed, he said this, stay with me, for God's sake, I cannot bear to be alone." I could go on and on. Sigmund Freud, a name you well know, psychiatrist and atheist, upon his death said this, "Now it is nothing but torture and makes no sense anymore." Now it is nothing but torture and it makes no sense anymore. God himself said in Psalm 14:1, "The fool has said in his heart, there is no God." Regarding those who died in faith in the Lord Jesus, George Washington, one of the last things out of his mouth before he exited this life, he said, "Doctor, I am dying, but I am not afraid." It is reported that he then folded his hands over his chest and ended his days on earth by saying, "It is well," our first president, because he was getting ready to meet Jesus. 2 days after collapsing on the floor of the House of Representatives by a stroke, John Quincy Adams said this, "This is the last of earth. I am content." Patrick Henry told his doctor as he lay dying, "I wish to observe how real and beneficial the faith of Christ is to a man about to die." He was the one who was famous for saying, "Give me liberty or give me death." A few hours before entering his eternal home, Dwight L. Moody caught a glimpse of glory waiting for him. Moody woke up from sleep and he said, "Earth recedes, heavens opens before me. If this is death, it is sweet. There's no valley here. God is calling me and I must go." Moody's son was standing at his bedside and said, "No, no, Father. You're dreaming." Dr. Moody soon replied, "No, I'm not dreaming. I have been within the gates. I have seen the children's faces." After a short time elapsed, Dr. Moody spoke once more. He said, "This is my triumph. This is my coronation day. It is glorious." The difference between being lost and being saved. Stephen, the martyr, was being stoned to death. And he said in Acts 7:56, he said, "Behold, I see heavens opened and the Son of Man standing on the right hand of God." That's what he saw on his deathbed. And then another Christian martyr, our beloved Apostle Paul, said this in Philippians 1:21, "For me to live is Christ, to die is gain." Again, he also said in 2 Corinthians 5:8, "We're confident, I say, willing rather to be absent from the body and to be present with the Lord." That's what the Apostle Paul said. No waiting, no purgatory, no limbo. No, he was going to be with Jesus. And the others were going to torture, to hell. You see. What a privilege it is to be saved. What a tragedy to die lost. If I'm a real friend of anybody, I won't let friends die without pleading with them to turn to Jesus for the only means of their forgiveness of sins and salvation. Nothing else. Acts 4:12. "Neither is there any other, for there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved." The psalmist describes the necessity of the soul winner in this 126th psalm. "He that goes forth weeping and bearing precious seeds shall doubtless come again with rejoicing, bringing his sheaves with him." Jesus said in Matthew 4:19, "Follow me and I will make you fishers of men." First of all, to be a fisher of men, in order to win souls for Christ and for eternity, the child of God needs to be involved in at least four things. Four things, if you're going to be a fisher of men. You've got to be going, you've got to be weeping, you've got to be sowing, and you will be reaping. Can somebody say amen? The soul winner's going. The soul winner's going. Look with me to Romans 10, verse 6. And we're going to get to the text. In Romans 10, verse 6, the Apostle Paul says this, "But the righteousness which is of faith speaks on this wise, say not in thy heart, who shall ascend to heaven, that is to bring Christ down from above? Who shall descend into the deep, that is to bring up Christ again from the dead? But what saith it? The word is nigh thee, even in thy mouth and in thy heart. That is the word of faith which we preach. That if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in thy heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved." Verse 10, "For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. For the scripture saith, whosoever believes on him shall not be ashamed, for there's no difference. For there's no difference between the Jew and the Greek, for the same Lord over all is rich to all that call upon him. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." And then he asks the question, "How shall they call on him in whom they have not believed? How shall they believe in him in whom they have not heard? How shall they hear without a preacher?" By the way, you could put your name there. It doesn't have to just be somebody who's in the office of a preacher. Every one of us are evangelists of God. "And how shall they preach except they be sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of them that preach the gospel of peace and bring good tidings of, bring glad tidings of good things. How beautiful are the feet of him that brings good news. What in the world are my feet or your feet have anything to do with being beautiful? Because if you don't go and I don't go, guess what? These people are not going to hear. Oh, they might hear about religion. They might hear about church. They might hear about a Bible. They might even hear about Jesus, but they won't hear the gospel. You can believe that Jesus died on the cross and still died and go to hell. There are people that believe all the specifics about the cross and they're dying and they're going to hell because no one has explained to them God's plan of redemption. And that's my job and your job and our job as a church and as a child of God, as a fisher of men. The lost are never commanded to go to church. Did you know that? The lost are never commanded to go to church. But we are repeatedly told to go out and bring them in. Repeatedly we're told to go out and bring them in. Listen to what Jesus says in Luke 14:23. And the Lord said to his servant, go out into the highways and hedges, compel them to come in that my house may be filled. Again, John 1:46, Nathanael said to him, can there any good thing come out of Nazareth? Philip said to him, come and see. You see, there has to be a going. There has to be a going. And you have to give the message. And you have to draw the net. The going is the commandment to share the gospel. The message is the cross. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 1 to 3. You see clearly, the Apostle Paul lays out what the gospel is. He said, moreover, brethren, I declare to you the gospel which I preach to you, which also you have received and wherein you stand, by which you're also saved if you keep in memory what I preached to you, unless you believed in vain. For I delivered to you, first of all, that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures. What scriptures? Isaiah 53, Psalm 22. Psalm 16, listen, it says according to the scriptures, and that he was buried, Psalm 16, and that he rose again the third day according to the scriptures. What is the gospel? There's the gospel. If you believe and you receive him and you place your faith in him and repent of your sin, he saves you. John 1:12 clearly says, but to as many as received him, to them gave he the power to become the sons of God, even to those that believe on his name. In John 3:16, we know the verse so well, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. But then we find also Jesus speaking in John 5:24. And what does he say there? Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that heareth my word and believeth on him that sent me hath everlasting life and shall not come into condemnation, but is passed from death unto life. But Paul reiterates, how are they going to know, how are they going to believe if nobody goes and if nobody tells? And that's why my feet are beautiful. That's why your feet are beautiful, because you're bringing the good news that brings somebody from death to life, that brings somebody from hell to heaven. Ephesians 2, verse 8 and 9. For by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. What is this thing that saves us? It's the favor of God, the absolute blessing of God bestowed upon the person who turns in faith to the Son of God. That's what saves you. That's the gospel. Acts 16:31. You know the story about Paul and Silas as they're in prison and it's the midnight hour and they're singing praises and they're in chains because they were preaching the gospel. And the jailer looks at them The chains fall off, and all the prisoners are free. The jailer takes his sword and he gets ready to kill himself because he knows if anybody gets out of that jail, he's dead. That's the penalty for letting a prisoner go free. And Paul shouts to them, "Do thyself no harm. We are still here. We haven't gone anywhere. Don't do this." And this jailer looks at Paul and Silas and says, "What must I do to be saved?" Paul didn't ignore him. Paul shared with him. He bore the precious seed. He said, "Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved, and thy house." Nothing happens until we go. But next, there needs to be some weeping for lost souls. How many of us have ever spent any time weeping for lost souls? Look at verse 5 again of this 126th Psalm. "They that sow in tears shall reap in joy." Verse 6 says, "Weepeth." Verse 5 says, "Soweth in tears." This speaks about having compassion for lost people. We need a burden. How long has it been since you or I shed tears for a lost person? Really, shed tears. "He that goeth forth weeping." Instead of looking down or condemning lost people, we need to start loving them. Can somebody say amen? The greatest compliment that ever was paid to our Savior was when he was called the name Friend of Sinners. Because in fact, he was a friend of sinners. He was a friend of publicans and sinners. Jesus never looked down on them. He loved them. Jesus said in John 15 and verse 13, "Greater love hath no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends." It's not enough just to be going and to be weeping. You see, if you love people like God loves people, you will have a burden for the lost. I must have that burden, that passion for the lost, and a sorrow that they're on their way to hell. Jesus wept over Jerusalem as he left after he presented himself on Palm Sunday as their king, because they would not. How often, he said, would I have gathered you like chicks, like babies, like a mother hen would do. He said, "I would have gathered you, but you would not." You would not respond. There's going to be people who are not going to respond, but that should never stop us from sorrowing over their loss. We must be sowing, sharing the gospel with the lost, planting. That's what sowing is. It's sowing the word of God into the lives of lost people. I love Oliver Green. He's with Jesus now, many, many years. But Oliver Green opened my eyes to how a lost person could possibly come to faith. You know, the old hyper-Calvinist idea is that people are dead, totally depraved, they're dead. When you go past somebody in a casket, they can't do anything. They can't want for anything. They can't commit sin anymore. They can't do anything good. They can't do anything bad. They're just dead. So to expect somebody like that, and that's what they claim we are like, to believe is ridiculous. They need a resurrection. And the resurrection happens when we plant the seed of the Word of God in their minds. Why is that? Because God's Word tells us again, Psalms, "The entrance of thy words giveth light." And that is into the mind of a person who is lost as well as a person who is saved. How does a lost person come to faith? The entrance of the word of God comes into their mind, and they come to the knowledge that God is real, and they come to a crossroads where God is bringing them to a place of they can either accept or reject what they're hearing, and it's up to that person to make a response. But the soul winner has to sow. He's bearing precious seed. Listen to what Jesus said in Luke 8. A sower went out to sow his seed, and as he sowed, some fell by the wayside. I'm in verse 5, by the way. It was trodden down, and the fowls of the air devoured it. Some fell upon a rock. As soon as it was sprung up, it withered away because it lacked moisture. Verse 7. Some fell among thorns, and a thorn sprang up with it and choked it. Other fell on good ground and sprang up and bore fruit 100-fold. When he had said these things, he cried, "He that has ears to hear, let him hear." His disciples asked him, saying, "What might this parable be?" Verse 10, he said, "Unto you it's given to know the mysteries of the kingdom, but to others in parables, that seeing they might not see and hearing they might not understand." Now the parable is this: the seed is the word of God. Jesus says this, the seed, the precious seed, is the word of God. Those by the wayside are those that hear. Then comes the devil and takes away the word out of their hearts, lest they should believe and be saved. When we plant the seed, the devil tries to come and steal it away. And then Jesus went on and he said this: they that are on the rock are they which, when they hear, receive the word with joy. And these have no root, which for a while believe, and in time of temptation they fall away. And then he goes on, and that which fell among thorns are they which, when they've heard, they go forth and are choked, and the cares and riches and pleasures of this life, and bring no fruit to perfection. But that on the good ground are they which, with an honest and good heart, having heard the word, keep it and bring forth fruit with patience. So Jesus said, this is the seed. It's the word. And they that bear precious seed. Peter said this in 1 Peter 1:23, being born again, not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible, by the word of God, which lives and abides forever. Peter said, that's how people are saved, by the hearing of the word of God. Born again by the word of God. Of not corruptible seed, but incorruptible. This tells us something. The word of God is not only to be gathered around us, it's to be scattered around us. Farmers don't stand in the middle of their field expecting something to grow or have a sudden harvest appear. They don't stand around a barrel of seed and pray for a harvest, do they? Think about that. Farmer doesn't stand around a barrel of seed and pray for a harvest. What do? They scatter it. And then the seed makes contact with the ground. And it will take root, but not inside the barrel. The problem with our churches is the seed is in the barrel. It's not getting out and being spread. It's not being sown. It's not my job to analyze or judge the soil. My job is to sow the seed. Can somebody say amen? In the parable of the sower, Jesus sowed seed into four places. By the wayside, the birds of the air ate it. On stony ground, the seed got in on the surface, but the rock wouldn't allow it to take root. He sowed it among thorns, and the seed got in and it went down, but then it couldn't get out. And on the good ground, Jesus said, it bore fruit. It's not for me to decide who will or who won't, you see. We're to invite everyone. Sometimes you feel like saying, don't waste your time on that person. I wonder if it was ever said of me before I was saved, don't waste your time on that guy. I'm glad that somebody wasted their time on me. The Apostle Paul wrote in 1 Corinthians 3:6, I have planted, he said, Apollos has watered, but God gave the increase. Going, weeping, sowing, and the soul winners reaping. Two words in this text I want to focus on and we're done. The word doubtless and the word shall. Doubtless be bringing his sheaves in verse 6. Verse 5, shall reap in joy. No joy I've ever experienced so great as leading somebody to Christ. You see, God's word says you shall reap in joy doubtless if you go forth sowing that precious seed. You see, we have to be sowing if we're planning to be reaping. 2 Corinthians 4, 3 says, but if our gospel is hid, it's hid to them that are lost. Who the devil has blinded their eyes. We're dealing with people who are deceived, blind. But the seed of the word and the spirit of God and the child of God will receive joy. Joy, joy. Unspeakable. Even as Jesus said, over one sinner that repents. There's joy in heaven and joy on earth when one person comes to the Savior. Do you want to have joy? Do you want to fulfill the Great Commission? Jesus said, go into all the world. Preach the gospel to every creature. It's the Great Commission, the great command. And yet, the two words that I think are the greatest in our text in Psalm 126 is shall and the word doubtless. God's word cannot lie. He that goeth forth weeping, bearing precious seed, shall doubtless come again, rejoicing, bringing his sheaves with him. When you get to heaven, there's only one thing you're going to take to heaven with you. And you know what that one thing is? Souls. Souls. People who you've influenced and led to Christ, who you've planted the seed of the Word of God into their lives. And I'm way out of time, but Dr. James Dobson probably used this illustration too many times, but Dobson said him and his family, Ryan, his son, Danae, his wife, and Danae is his daughter, and Shirley, his wife, were playing Monopoly. And it's getting late, and he's cleaning house. He's winning this Monopoly game away from his family. First, Shirley went bankrupt. Then Danae went bankrupt, threw their token in. And then, just before midnight, Ryan said, well, Dad, I guess you win. He took his token and threw it in. He said, you get to put everything away. And Dr. Dobson said he realized something. At the end of the day, everything goes back in the box. Everything goes back in the box. We don't take it with us. Nothing we take. He won all this money and all this property, and he now has the title, the winner of the Monopoly table. But guess what? None of that goes with us. It goes back in the box. He said there's only one thing that we take with us when we leave, and that's souls. People whom we have helped to bring to the Savior. Joy. Let's stand together. Lord God, you have clearly laid out in your word the promise, Lord, that if we'll do what you said to do, that there will be results. Obviously, Lord, doubtless, Lord, it's not being done. The seed is left in the barrel. Lord Jesus, help us to take that precious seed, your word that has the ability to give life, and to sow it into people's lives. And Lord, as we sow and others water, you will bring the increase. Oh God, forgive us for being so careless. Forgive us, Lord God, for being so passionless. Lord, fill us with your Holy Spirit. Empty us of ourselves. And Lord, recommission us by your Spirit to be going, weeping, sowing, and reaping for the kingdom of Christ's sake and for our joy. We give you praise and we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Would you take your hymnal? before we sing this hymn, I think, Daniel, you have a song. What is the number of that song? I would like to give it to Mrs. Gulp. The 446. That's not the one, I'm sorry. Number 322. In remembrance.
We're going to celebrate the Lord's table.
This one.